Here at the Nature Files, our next case is about none other than the lifeblood of the Pacific Northwest. Of course, I'm talking about salmon. Each spring, mature salmon begin an epic journey from the ocean back to their natal river to spawn and then die. As their carcasses decompose, they feed a myriad of animals, from bears to birds, and help trees grow to become giants. So when climate change and other global forces like logging threaten salmon populations, people tend to notice. Thankfully, here in coastal British Columbia, salmon are under the vigilant eye of the guardian watchman. But what can a community do to protect the struggling salmon? Join us as we crack the code on nature and unlock mysteries in The Nature Files.
And so I ran.
Away from there.
But right behind.
He was a bear.
And so I ran
away from there. But right behind me was a bear.
Working in Grizzly Country is familiar territory for Gina Thomas and her crew. Every month for the last 5 years, they've been conducting eDNA sampling here in the Fulmore Lake region, an ecologically diverse and productive watershed, as part of a long-term monitoring project with the Tlowitsis Nation.
Gaelicasla, Nuguayam, Histislas. My English name is Gina Thomas. So as guardian watchmen for the Tlowitsis people, we are what we call the eyes and ears for the band. Our role in many ways is to capture the information and data collection in many, many ways and forms to help make decisions on better management.
Historically, the Fulmore Lake area had all five species of Pacific salmon in it, but more than a century of logging here has had an indisputable impact, leaving unstable shorelines vulnerable to landslides, which destroy spawning grounds. Virginia, a forestry professional turned forest protector, helping the struggling salmon make a comeback is personal.
Before I started as a guardian, I worked in the forest industry for about 20 years, and it was very unfulfilling work. I didn't feel like we were doing anything good. Actually, the industry I found was doing a lot of detriment. I'm finding that our fish populations are dwindling due to forestry. And I am making it my career in this point in my life to prove it.
A fish counter on the river, operated by Fisheries and Oceans Canada for the last few years, has shown drastically reduced sockeye, pink, and coho since their previous estimates from the 1960s when the area was monitored last.
In the last year or so, we've been counting sockeye coming in. Historically, they quoted up to about 10,000. Last year, we only had about 2,700 come through the fence.
Today, Gina Thomas and her two fellow guardian watchmen are taking eDNA water samples from various monitoring sites to try and hone in on where the salmon are getting stuck, tracking the different species of salmon on their migration routes from the Fulmore estuary up the river to the lake.
According to Gina, these five different salmonid species were known to exist in the Fulmore system. So they wanted to know if they were coming back to this area, because one of their main spawning grounds on the side of the Fulmore Lake apparently had been destroyed from erosion.
After getting water samples from the estuary, river, and lake, they filter the water to separate out the traces of DNA left by the salmon in the water, like dead skin cells. Then, they send all their DNA samples to a lab at the Hakai Institute on Quadra Island for extraction and analysis. This is all part of a larger project called the Integrated Coastal Observatory, or ICO. Once a sample has been sequenced and given an ID, it's uploaded to a public website where anyone can go and view the data.
So essentially, since this, the ICO eDNA work is a long-term monitoring project, we can get a nice time series of data looking at these fish communities over time, and that can better inform communities about any sort of changes that's happening. It's been very interesting. We've had a few years of data in the system, which has shown us some really interesting patterns.
The most recent eDNA results from the Fulmore Lake region in 2022 show that only two of the five species of salmon, sockeye and coho, were making it from the estuary all the way to the lake. Perhaps not surprisingly, the sockeye appear to have abandoned previous spawning beds that have been impacted by landslides that likely occurred due to the logging. The eDNA also shows that the timing of the migrations is not what they expected.
We always thought the spring salmon came in the early winter, and with the eDNA, we're finding that they're coming in midsummer. So the eDNA is also helping us time the fish species because there's no other way to visually see them other than the bears eating them.
They're also hoping to use eDNA in the future to track some of the much smaller residents of these waters that are invisible to the human eye, like invertebrates, which are the basis of the food chain but struggle to survive in the muddied up waters.
The reason we got into doing this work is we want to protect our backyard. We have whales and we have grizzly bears and we have big trees and lots of salmon. So we're here to protect this and to document it and to share it with others.
eDNA is one key piece to the puzzle when it comes to understanding the ecological health of the Fulmore watershed. By gathering these findings and making better management decisions in the future, the Tlowitsis Nation can work to restore fish populations and habitats where they're most vulnerable. That's a case closed for the spawning sockeye, for now anyways. So, shall we crack open our next case file? Next week on the Nature Files, we explore the case of the scattered salmon and find out how we can push eDNA technology even further.